Preparing to delve in 3, 2, 1.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Delve. My name is Nathan.
And I'm Alex.
And you know, Alex, it occurs to me that over the last 5 years of doing the show, we've made some real progression in our podcasting levels. Have you noticed that?
I've noticed something.
You've noticed something, yeah. Do you think our stats are higher now?
Probably not.
No, they probably aren't. Not if analytics are to be believed. But you know what's great? On the show today, we are very happy to welcome back Emelie Van Rodin, a game designer and creator of State of Wonder, which is why Emelie was on before. Van, thank you for being on.
Thank you for having me, and it's been a long time. Yeah. It's kind of like being back is really good, and it's awesome, and yeah.
Yeah, it certainly is, and I did hear that you know, State of Wonder seems to be going well.
Yeah, State of Wonder has been doing really good in the last quarter. We've been selling a lot more. We're growing, and we just released our latest expansion in March called The Remnants of the End. The players have been loving it, and the Bronze Bard is in it, and everyone is sharing that there's a bard in it.
That's great, and I'm really happy to hear about that. But that's actually not why you're on the show today, because you are also a very well-known game designer and have worked on many different projects.
Yes, I kind of work like a small scale freelance game designer. I do game design for people that hire me in, and I also do license deals or license things where I work on systems behind the scene. I kind of improve people's game designs as kind of my side work as well. I also have a bachelor's in game design specifically, which I'm going to work towards a master's, and I've worked with brand design and stuff like that. So it's all design, it's all coverage, and it's all fun.
It's all really awesome stuff.
You came on the show so that we could talk a little bit about something you've been thinking about recently, which is progression systems, right?
Yes, progression system in specifically tabletop role-playing games, like Dungeons & Dragons, stuff like this. I'm saying stuff like this because I only have Swedish games on my mind, but like Mutant Year Zero or Paths, these style of where you sit around in a group and you have a game master and your group is playing the game and someone is telling the story to the players and the players are playing heroes or investigators or protagonists of a story which is unfolding before them and everyone is telling the story together. It's a very interesting design space because you don't really know what goes into it and the game master is as much a game designer as you are.
Right, yeah, that is always the tricky relationship between the designer and then the person who's actually going to be running the game, because they will make some edits on their own.
Those edits aren't necessarily bad. I love when game masters take something and make it something that fits their group, because why wouldn't they? They want the best experience they can get. Change the system, break the system.
Mm-hmm.
Do that, because that's how you know you're playing something you like, is when you start changing the system to work for your playgroup. If you like to play superhero role-playing games, then everyone should be superheroes. This is why Star Wars generally fall apart as a role-playing game system to many, because one person wants to play the Jedi, and then everyone has to play Jedis, and then the Jedi isn't special anymore, and then... Yeah, it's...
One person plays a Jedi, and then someone's got to play General Grievous, and then that's over with.
Yeah, that was like when they decided to do the Old Republic online, and I was like, aren't the Jedi characters going to be a little OP for that system? If you could be smugglers and other things? I don't know how that works.
You find other ways to balance that out.
Yeah, but like in system, as a designer, I need to design... If I were designing a Star Wars game, Jedi powers and Force powers would most likely be really stupidly powerful. They should be.
They're on par with magic in like other systems too, though.
Yes, but in other systems... like D&D, magic is mostly a utility tool, or I have an extra arrow that I can shoot at people. So it depends on the magic system. And now we're talking about magic systems, which are really interesting. There's so many different magic systems, and I love it.
What prompted you to start thinking a lot about progression systems specifically?
Okay, so I've been a long-time D&D player. I've been playing for 12 years. I went over to Pathfinder some years ago because it was the game in my community. And we started playing Pathfinder and we never left it. And Pathfinder have this hard XP system where you're given experience when you kill monsters. It sounds functional. The problem is it isn't very functional. Because if I kill 3 goblins and a harpy and 2 hobgoblins and an orc, and then we have to split that on the party of 5, then how much experience points am I getting? Then someone needs to calculate that. What has started happening is we just have this style where the GM goes, when we end tonight's game session, everyone gets a level. Level up your characters. There's no inherent, like, the game master needs to either keep track of all the monsters everyone kills, or the players needs to do it, or someone needs to have all the math done. And that's not very fun when you're in the middle of a battle or doing all the awesome things you can do in a role-playing game, like, I want to jump up on a table and try to bluff my way to looking like a really powerful robber, and I want them to run away. And that didn't work out very well. And we were attacked by the level 7 guard, and that we had to run away.
So you're working on, like, the milestone kind of system.
Yes. So basically, when do characters become more powerful, or how do characters become more powerful in the story, or how do they progress through the story, either negatively or positively? Like Cthulhu games often have sanity systems, which are basically their progression systems, whereas the more you play, the more insane your character becomes, and at the end you most likely either go insane or be so close to breaking that it will change how you play your character. And that's, I really love that system because it's about negative progression, or you don't become more powerful, you become less powerful, but you have to do it for the greater good of saving mankind from Cthulhu.
Yeah, recently Alex and I had a conversation where we kind of did pros and cons for the experience system versus the milestone system.
Yes, we did.
And I still like a milestone system just because it feels like there are certain benchmarks where your characters feel like they should be, you know, progressing a little bit, and you should be able to see that. But I mean, Alex did make a fair enough case for the experience system.
Did I? Oh, good. I mean, the one you were talking about over there was the Pathfinder one is the holdover from 3.5, I believe, because Pathfinder obviously is 3.5 plus, essentially.
There is going to be a second edition. They're working
on that. It's still based off the 3.5 OGL. And the experience system was really weird for that exact reason, because it's like, oh, we killed a group of monsters, but we have to divide up all the XP for the amount of people in the party. And it's just it's a really weird math thing that doesn't make a lot of sense, honestly.
Yeah, and it's very tedious. And I think
it is.
And I've seen, I have some other systems that I've played over the years. I think World of Darkness does experience extremely well compared to Pathfinder. It's a very small number of experience points needed to do things, and players basically spend them themselves by, like, say, I want to spend experience points leveling up my agility. I don't know if it's agility or dexterity or strength or whatever you want to spend it on. And World of Darkness kind of has that experience system where the more experience you gain, the more powerful your characters become and the more powers you get. But giving out experience points is really easy. You can't say, you gain an experience point. You gain an experience point. Instead of the, you gain 3,845.514 experience points.
That, I think the spending experience thing to gain powers and gain levels type deal, like World of Darkness, I think that's really something Fantasy Flight likes to do. Because they did that with all the Warhammer 40K and Warhammer Fantasy RPs as well. Legend of the Five Rings, it wasn't like in the hundreds where you gain the experience. It was like you gain a point of experience here and there, and you spend like 3 to 10 experience when you accumulate it on leveling things up as well. And I think those are really interesting systems because typically they self-balance a lot better than, say, D&D would, just by leveling up as you go, because you're picking and choosing what you want to level, as opposed to just saying overall level and gaining a ton of stuff.
Yeah, and I really like the easier, like, pick and choose, spend your experience points however you want. Because one, you can build your own character, but it also introduces, okay, my character has now learned to use pistols, or I've been using pistols a lot. Do I want to move into firearms, or how has my character progressed? I can basically pick and choose whatever fits my character as I work through the game sessions and level that.
Right. You have a very open-ended pathway for you to progress.
Exactly. One of the things I really liked about World of Darkness was that I also introduced humanity, and now I'm babbling about a lot about World of Darkness, but I actually LARPed the World of Darkness for like 4 years, and I role-played it during those 4 years as well, so I have pretty like, this is one of my like nostalgia systems. I really love it from a nostalgia point of view, but there's a lot of broken things in that system.
What edition of World of Darkness are you actually familiar with?
I primarily played old. When I played the pen and paper role-playing game, but I've played both the old and the new one, Old World of Darkness and New World of Darkness. I haven't played the last one of the Old World of Darkness, the latest one that was released in 2018, I think it was.
5e, yep.
Yeah, so I played the one before that.
The last one I played was years ago.
Yeah, it's like I played in 2007, 2008 maybe.
Last time I played World of Darkness was at least 5 years ago.
Yeah, so it's in the same time frame from what you're used to. I really love the Paths and Humanity system because it gave your character progression that wasn't inherently about how powerful your character was, like the Call of Cthulhu Insanity. Humanity is about keeping your humanity and not becoming a monster at like one or two humanity. Mm-hmm. While the Paths are about strafing to become something really great about what you're doing. Those kinds of non-power-based progression systems, I think, are the driving factors behind some characters, but it can very easily become like overshadowed by just everything. Why would I care about my humanity if nothing changes for my character, except whenever I do a humanity eye roll, I get dice. So it's weird.
Yeah, no, I guess I was never really very familiar with World of Darkness myself, but then again, I'm not really familiar with most systems, so...
that's fair.
When you level up in, like, a World of Darkness, what do your characters actually receive? Do they get stat points? Do they get abilities?
The thing is, you never actually level up in World of Darkness.
Okay.
You get experience points, and then you can spend your experience points into abilities, like, oh, I want to increase my dementation power one step. That costs me 21 experience points to move it from 2 to 3. Or I want to increase my strength from 3 to 4. That costs me 20 experience points. And then you can do that between sessions, if I remember correctly. And then you get experience from sessions for doing either plot-based things or by defeating enemies or whatever your GM wants to give you experience points for.
Oh, okay. So there's even a way to get experience points for, like, narrative choices that you make?
Yeah, exactly. You can basically get experience points by doing something really... I played a Oracle character who had a semi-magical tarot deck, which would always give someone a true reading. So whenever I flipped, there was no way my readings could become false.
That can't go bad at all.
That can go really wrong. I played a Malkavian, and all Malkavians have a kind of mental illness. And my character had a very powerful OCD-like illness where I had to, whenever I met someone new or saw someone new, if in the case of mortals, I had to take their reading. This didn't turn out very well when we were in a chase with police over a bridge in high speed. They were putting me in the control over the vehicle because someone was shot by a fire breath round in the back and we had to heal them. And I see in the back mirror that I haven't read this policeman. So I just stand on my brakes in this high speed pursuit and the entire car swerves over and I run up to the policeman and they start shooting me with guns. And
yeah,
most vampires don't really fear guns. They fear like fire breath and stuff. And then I run up, put up my small reading table and sit down and start reading him while he's screaming at me. And the last card I flip is death, just as our Gangrel player, which are like basic bestial vampires, just throws himself over the policeman and rips him to shreds. And I'm like, I am never wrong. Picks up my cards and go back to the vehicle.
And another right fortune telling by me.
That one's a really awesome character, and I had to work a lot with the game master to make it really work, because like we basically had to be in sync. I couldn't just go up and read everyone at the new places we visited, because that wouldn't work. So we had to basically like read each other. When was it time to do these weird reading scenarios? I actually got a lot of experience points for that thing on the bridge, though, because our GM was rolling on the floor laughing for like a good 20 minutes because it basically turned into a fight for our characters' lives. And my character couldn't fight. My character was the only character in the entire party that would lose to a human in combat. By my character doing this, I was basically risking the entire party. Everyone in the, why are you doing this? And I'm like, I haven't read that person.
Right.
So during the battle, everyone was running around killing people while I was seeing if there was anyone I hadn't read yet before they died. So I was running around doing that while everyone else was fighting.
Hey, you go with your strengths, you know? I find it interesting, the idea that you could actually get, like, you know, experience points for non-combat related things. Alex, you'll probably remember at one point we had talked on the show about how it would really be hard to introduce something like that to a Dungeons & Dragons, because you would just have a barbarian go around, just try to intimidate people, and as long as they keep making intimidation checks, they'll just keep getting experience.
You need to be able to quantify the experience you give for the action that you do. And I think that's the reason a lot of systems, not all of them, can do the combat and the objectives type deal, and the milestone type things give you XP or give you levels. The roleplay aspects are a lot harder to really quantify the experience you give, because you can just have that one person in your party who just roleplays their character to a fault and just gains all the experience, and they're like 20 right. levels higher than everyone.
The good thing about In World of Darkness, like where you gain experience points by the GM just giving them to you, is that they can basically try to keep it even between the party. I would never go into combat, so I would never gain combat experience, except that one time I rolled a critical hit on someone in the head with a pistol I had stolen from them. But that was the luck of the dice, not me being good in combat, because I had one dice with shooting the gun. Right. And that was really bad. I had to roll a 10, followed by a 10, to actually kill him. And I did.
Yeah, I did it.
The dice can be fickle, but they can also be really great in certain circumstances. I like the idea of World of Darkness, and it makes me want to look at the system more, because I was just starting to think, like, could you have systems where you don't necessarily gain levels, but you get skill points or you get experience that you can then use to make your character more powerful,
I
without
have
there being a hard number.
Games to talk about now.
Let's hear about that.
I was like, I have two games for you.
Oh, tell me about these games, please.
Okay, so the first one is Aeon. I've primarily played second edition of Aeon. I don't want to say hardcore, but it's like a really in-depth medieval. It's more medieval than fantasy. Kind of system. You don't level, actually. Basically, you get a critical hit when you use a attack or a disguise or whatever you're doing. You mark that skill. And at the end of the session, you get one chance where you roll 3d6. And you need to roll over your skill. And if you do, you increase that skill by 1 point. Characters have between 5 and 15 in every skill. Or you can have more than 15, but you start with between 5 and 15. So if you have 15, you need to roll 3d6, roll a 6, and then you pick up that 6 and roll 2 new dice. And if you roll a 6 on those, you do that again, and you do it again until you stop rolling 6s.
Okay.
So you can basically roll any number in Aeon, which is really weird, even in combat. Like, if I attack you, this is the damage system. So if I roll 2 6s, I pick up 5 and roll those, and that's my roll instead. And if I roll 2 more 6s, I roll 4 dice, and then you keep going. But like, the progression system overall is basically I use skills, and as I use skills, they become better. And this applies to like every kind of skill. It applies to like, if I use swords, I have a sword skill, which I can increase. If I am a specialized fighter, I have a fighter skill, which I can use, which I can increase. If I have a bow or archery, I use that and it increases. If I have sleight of hand, I use it, it increases. But it also applies to like your primary values. So if you're like lifting something really heavy, then you do a strength roll. And if you crit that strength roll, you get a chance to increase your strength. And increasing your strength is really valuable in this game. Like every character is a nerfed D&D character. So you have like 10 strength is actually decent. A good fighter can have 11 or 12 and be good.
Yeah, it definitely sounds like something like you see in video games more often than tabletop. And that's something we did mention before, is that it's hard to do the bookkeeping necessarily to level skills up that way.
Yeah, but since it's always only, if you crit one, you mark that skill and you can't mark it again. So if you crit your sword fighting skill, well, you don't have to do it again and do it again and do it again, because it's only once. And then at the end of the session, you start rolling them up and then it's them. And it's actually really fun, because then you know that if you get into a combat encounter, I will most likely get a chance to increase my fighting attributes. If I get into a social encounter and I need to perform an epic dance, I will most likely not get to increase it, but I have a chance to increase it, and it's really...
Does it depend on if there's a disco ball? Disco ball... Yeah, I think if there's a disco ball, you get like an automatic chance to increase your epic dance.
There's another way to increase them, and it's basically downtime increasing things. For every week your character is inactive, you can choose to train a certain amount of skills. Basically, if your character, if you need to leave a game a longer period of time, then your character can come back and have a chance to not still be relevant. Because if everyone is running around with 23 in shield and sword, and you're coming back with 16, the threats that's going to attack you is most likely you're not going to be good enough to fight them.
That's an interesting system, because it takes a little bit of like strategy and a little bit of skill, but also a little bit of luck in order for your characters to really increase, if I'm understanding it correctly.
Yeah. Basically that.
Yeah, that's good. So you have a lot of different kind of factors that are going into basically determining whether you can raise it up. Do you think that system benefits from having like a lower threshold for a lot of the stats?
Yeah, like a good character in Aeon has, as I mentioned, like 10 to 12 in a stat, especially when you roll non-hero, which is a thing in Aeon. But if you roll heroes, you generally have 12 to 15, most stats. You have a dip stat, you have two dip stats because you have 9 primary stats. And then you start like building these things with skill points, and skill points, the starter skill points are really weird to put out. But you start with basically 11 is a pretty decent score. The more you put into a skill, the harder it is to actually make it better. So if you're actually building a really good fighter, putting all the 15 into it might not be worth it, because you will be using your fighting skill so much that you might want to use those skills at something else, like hunting or tracking or whatever else you want to put it into. Just so you, because you know that you will be using your fighty thing. So you will most likely get to increase your fighty thing every time, because combat in Aeon is fatigue-based more than anything else. And as mentioned earlier, you can do any amount of damage, but most attacks do like 3d6 or 4d6 of damage. And if I have 40 resistance points, I remove 40 points.
So it's a like a rollover dice system for damage.
Yes. And if my character is wearing 40 points of armor and you're attacking me for 4d6, you can see this not working out very well for you.
No.
And this is really not the worst thing about it. The so it's when you're carrying 40 points of resistance armor, you actually gain like 2 or 3 points of a fatigue a turn, depending on how strong your character is. When you run out of fatigue, your character basically just falls, and that's when combat ends. So it ends with someone just ripping the helmet of someone, and then taking off their chainmail coif and taking off their gambeson hood, and then sticking them with a dagger to the eye. And that's basically how combat ends. Because people in armor are tanks in the medieval era, especially if they're on horses, because then they don't take as much fatigue. So basically, if you're battling mounted against people on horses, then the goal is to shoot their horse with a crossbow, and then wear them out by doing hit and run attack with lances. Either kill them with the lance, or they fall over, and then you do that for everyone else. Okay. As I said, it's more like a medieval simulator than it's actually a fantasy role-playing game. But that's why a lot of people love it, because it's so intense in that way. It's also a little bit funny when you hit them in the eye and you roll a 6 for damage, and then you roll 2 sixes for damage, and then you roll 4 d6s of damage, and they're all 6s. And then you roll 8 d6s of damage, and they're all 6s. And someone goes like, this is unreasonable.
So your d6s are like exploding d6s.
Yes, exploding d6s. So whenever you roll a 6, you get 2 dice instead of the 6, and then you roll those.
Okay. Yeah, because the one system that I'm familiar with besides D&D is Open Legend. And in Open Legend, they actually do have, they have a rollover system and an exploding dice system. You have different realms of what you can do. There's like physical abilities, mental abilities, social abilities. But then there's also 3 different feats for guard, toughness, and resolve. Yeah. And you'll have a certain number for that. And so depending on what kind of attack you're doing, it hits up against one of those 3 attributes. And if you're able to get over the number that your character has, if you have like a guard and your guard is like 15, if you can get over that 15, you're in good shape. But maybe their resolve is really low, so a magical attack is going to work better on them. And that has an exploding system, but it's also a d20 system. So if you crit on a d20, you get to roll your d20 again.
That's pretty good.
The way that your skills increase is not, you'll always roll your d20 for a skill, but if you have points into any of those skills, you also roll an additional die. So like either a d4, d6, or 2d6. And if any of those are crits, if they land on their highest value, you can also reroll those. So theoretically, if you're really good at a skill, you might end up rolling 4 different dice, and any of them could end up exploding. So I've seen
D4s are good in this system.
D4s actually end up being way better, because percentile-wise, you have a good chance of exploding in that.
After playing Aeon for a while, you get used to player death being just around the corner every time you play. Because, like, we had a character that loaded up a siege weapon, and he critically failed with the siege weapon. And not only did he roll, like, 37 on his siege weapon roll, the siege weapon actually failed its hold together from damage roll. So the chain on the ballista or scorpion just broke and hit him, and hitting him for so much damage that he was just instant severed in the middle. He also failed his amputation roll, which is also a thing in this game. So he was amputated over his middle part of his body. And he was just like, well, that's what happened when you play Aeon for too long.
Suddenly
amputated. Gotta love those random numbers, though. Oopsies.
Random numbers without end is the best way to get someone to die by a snowball to the face.
But you know,
I mean, within reason, yes.
So, you know, how'd your character die? Snowball fight?
The snowball had an ice crystal that went into your eye socket and then killed you.
Turns out that snowball made of ice, like Sub-Zero.
Yeah. I told you guys I had actually 2 systems from Sweden who does weird things with experience. The other one is the old Dungeons and Dragons, but in Swedish. It's called the Drakar and the Demoner, or Drakar och Demoner. So it's basically Dragons and Demons, but in Swedish.
Oh, okay.
And they have a hero point system where your characters journey through the world and you gain hero points. I know that hero points have another use in like the 5th edition and Pathfinder, where they have like, you can use them to do cool stuff, but that's not what hero points are here. They're basically modified World of Darkness experience points. But the thing that makes them actually really interesting is that they're also villain points. Basically, the more hero points and villain points you have, the more known you are in the world. So if you have 1 hero point, every NPC has a 1% chance to recognize you. And this escalates. When you start getting like 40 hero points or 50 hero points, then a lot of people start recognizing you. And that's not always something you want.
Okay, so that's kind of like fame or infamy in some cases.
Yeah, and basically hero points and villain points work the exact same way when it's about fame. What makes them different is that you can't use villain to progress your character at all. So if you do something really bad, then people will recognize you, and you're not even like better as to handle the salute, the thing, because villain points can't be used to protect yourself or to make yourself better. But we actually had an entire campaign based around villain points, where one of the characters incidentally killed an entire race of merfolk, basically. He incidentally did it because they had found a artifact that could basically move oceans. And it's not very good to throw an ocean into the air with an entire race of merfolk in it. So all
I'm guessing that didn't stop them.
So all the merfolk and everyone on the ocean or around the ocean where he threw, where the item was used, basically died. He also played a very unintelligent goblin, so he didn't understand that it was a magical item at all. And he got 85 villain points, and everyone thought he was one powerful wizard of all time. So the entire campaign was how they were trying to escape from really powerful guards and bounty hunters. And like this well-structured campaign by the GM just fell to the ground. Like I had to rebuild everything because my fully planned out campaign would just not work anymore. So the entire campaign became they were hunted because they had this goblin.
I am usually the goblin in every campaign, in every role-playing game I play. What did Nathan's character do? Well, I got a lot of villain points.
Now that we're talking about that, I actually just realized they actually have a progression system for trauma as well in that game, which is really cool.
Oh, okay. How does that work?
So, whenever your character sees something that is scary or traumatic, you roll on a table and you get a trauma thing. And the deeper into the trauma thing you go, the more you have to roll on it and the harder you have to roll on it. It works really well for the first like 3 or 4 or maybe 5 trauma rolls, depending on what the event is. But after a while, it becomes weird because it's just so much. And the last steps on these are like comatose for 2d6 years.
Oh, geez. Unplayable.
Instant death by heart attack. So that's the two last steps on this. And we basically had a character rolled on this 4 times during a dungeon. The first time they rolled fear of fire, so they're afraid of fire now. Second time they rolled fear of horses or equinophobia.
So what if they encounter nightmares then? Just
it gets worse. Flaming horses. And they encounter the nightmare thing.
Oh jeez.
becomes afraid of magic and divine beings. And nightmares counts as hell beasts, which is a kind of divine being in this world.
And they're on fire and they're magic.
Yes.
And they're horse.
So they get into an encounter. They're trying to get out of a dungeon. And in comes this knight riding on a... He was also afraid of shadows, which doesn't make this better.
Nope.
So in rides a dread knight upon a nightmare. And we start rolling trauma checks on his characters. All of a sudden, he rolls a 36, which is the... You fall in coma for 2d6 years. And everyone is like, your character is dead. You should just roll a new character. But he actually survives that encounter because the guy doesn't fight him. It fights the other guys instead. For some reason, they decide to carry his body with him for the rest of the campaign. And they get to a tavern where they leave him to go shopping. And then they realize, oh my god, it's the Chrono Guard, which is hunting us because we... kind of threw an ocean into the air. It's the same campaign. And they just all ditch the city, and then someone suddenly remembers, hey, where's the comatose guy? Yeah. They're seeing the city burning in the background. Everyone is like, we forgot him. Everyone forgot him.
6 years later, where am I?
We actually just ruled that his character didn't survive the Chrono attack, and we just went on with our lives, and he played another character. He already played another character at that point. They were just carrying around their friend's body because no one else would take care of him for the amount of years he would be out, so...
I was sitting there like, that wouldn't have been fun for me if I were playing the comatose character. I would think that... I would certainly hope I was doing something so he had another character that he was able to play.
Yeah, he played a... he played another. And it went really well. The entire campaign ended with the Chrono catching them and a Chrono Mage basically taking the goblin and facing him out of time together with half the party and everyone else escaping because no one liked the goblin.
Now, when you're talking about, like, the trauma system and like, the mental, like, psychosis thing, didn't they do something similar to that in Call of Cthulhu?
Yeah, they have an insanity system where characters break apart the more you play. I'm going to be honest here. I haven't played a lot of Call of Cthulhu. I've read a lot of the Call of Cthulhu games and how they work, but I haven't played it. It's hard for me to go into details on how it works. It's basically you have insanity. You have sanity. Don't lose it, because the more you lose it, the less people will care about what you say, and you will get physically hurt by being insane. Going insane or being in trauma is never a good thing for your character.
Yeah.
And that's kind of one of the things I like from negative progression systems. I'm going to call them negative progression systems now.
Sure.
There you go.
Sure.
New term.
It's that they're
bizarro progression systems.
Yeah.
They're like the superhero one, but the bizarre version, where things are in reverse.
Yeah, and they add so much, because it's so much more fun to play on flaws and how your character doesn't, how your character isn't good at something. Right now we're playing Pathfinder, and Pathfinder doesn't have a negative progression system, but like I'm playing a assassin rat folk, which is really good at doing assassin stuff. Every fight I kill all the enemies. That's basically my job. Kill all the enemies. and I'm really good at that. Whenever we go into a chop, my character starts going around and like just lifting everything around and putting it down. So the group have started to not bring me to shops because I have to ask a GM. I want a full list of everything in the store, and then I want to go around and pick it up.
And, well, there you go.
And it's a real big problem when you go into a glass store where they sell glass items, like vanity, like glass collector items or glasses, or a boat that looks like a actual boat that is 1 meter tall in pure glass. It's a problem putting my character in that shop because I start running around and picking everything up and like just putting it down non-gently, because now I've looked at it now. We basically role play it into some funny moments when it works, and then we don't do that when we're like, yeah, we just need to repair items, or we're just going in to get food. It's one of the things that just can create role-playing moments whenever the GM wants to do them. And as long as I'm doing them, the rest of the group like kind of see them coming. I'm also insensitive to other people's feelings a lot. If someone like gets their father murdered in front of them, I will tell them, your father just died. And I've actually done that in a campaign. Someone crucified our innkeeper's father in the building where he worked. And she had been kidnapped, so she hadn't seen it yet. And she asked, I need to go and find my father. And I was crucifixion thing, dead. And everyone in the group just looked at me and like, how can you say that? And I was like, I'm looking at these really stylish, demonic pictures that the guy who kidnapped her had. I'm focused on something else. That was a lot of fun. I love that current campaign, and I love my character.
So we have those systems. What else?
Yeah, so I've actually been working on a progression system lately because game design and stuff. But one of the big things I've been doing is I firstly wanted to remove the game master from the progression system. So it's basically on the players to progress. But there needs to be a limit to it. So that's the first thing I wanted to obtain. So the players kind of dictate the pace at which they become better, both progression-wise, but also story-wise. Or better is a strong word, story-wise. But the story progresses and they become better. But I also wanted the game master to have some kind of control, and I wanted it to be story-driven. So there's a lot of things. There's a lot of moving parts.
Right. Well, you got to start with goals before you actually get into what the system is. So that's good. Yeah.
So that's what I wanted to do. And the system has turned into a resource system. So players have conviction. They're basically players are playing as crusaders, mujahideen, different kind of holy warriors, templars in a post-apocalyptic Mad Max style world where there's no guns. So everyone is running around with like pipes and hitting each other and chainsaws and stuff while they're devotees to gods to set the setting up.
Yeah.
So players have conviction. That's what separates players from other characters or NPCs. And conviction can be burnt to gain either use very powerful abilities like shapeshift and stuff like that, or it can be used to basically, I improve my roll so all my dice succeed, or I improve my roll so I roll extra dice, or whatever you want it to do, or you can refill all your other resources or heal to full using conviction, depending on the amount of conviction you spend. Most players have 5 to 8. So okay, whenever you burn a conviction, you lose it permanently. But you gain an experience point whenever you do that. When you hit 0 conviction, your character can go on a pilgrimage to your either your god or your religion to refill your conviction. At the start, they are going to be the low-level kind. You choose which ones you go on. And most people are going to go on the ones like defeat a religious enemy in one-on-one combat, because that can be pretty easy to do. You can't repeat pilgrimages because your gods don't care. You've already done that. So the more pilgrimages you do, the longer and longer down the list of bad things you need to do appear. We have a god that we've worked on that is basically a everything in excess is the keyword. So starving yourself to death, eating until you're super full, drinking until you're so drunk you pass out. All of those things are things this god wants you to do. And one of their later pilgrimages is basically starve yourself, kill your best friend in single combat, and eat their body in one sitting. And that's the pilgrimage. But then you get to reset your conviction. And everything is good.
Well, I mean, not for your friend.
Not for your friend, because no, they're pretty much very dead.
Yeah, they're. But for you, it's great for you.
Basically, I wanted to create a system where you want to progress through it because your character gets more powerful because you gain experience points, like the heavy experience points in World of Darkness, where you spend them to spend on skills, which you can increase. But the further you progress and the more powerful you become, the more the god or the religion that you're worshiping wants you to do to gain that back. So they want you to keep going down this journey that will most likely bring most characters to, in the end, realize, what am I actually doing? That's basically where I want to end up with the system, where players basically fall into this and start doing the pilgrimages on repeat because I want to make my character stronger. And then right, you start getting to the end of these lists and you're like, yikes.
Yeah.
I was already like, yikes. Yikes. It's just getting more yikes.
And when you get to the end of the list, it's supposed to be this, do you turn around or do you become even more powerful to face the dangers ahead that you will be facing? It's a very depressing game system where it's like everyone is becoming more and more powerful by sacrificing parts of themselves to become more and more devoted to their gods.
Right.
To be able to gain more and more power from their gods, they have to sacrifice their friends, their own personalities. They have to do all of this. So the pilgrimages are going to be very iconic for each god and each religion. If you don't like that kind of game, it's going to be really hard to pitch this game to people. But it's like, I've talked to some game masters who want to play test this as soon as I'm done with it. And they're like, I want to play this because it sounds awesome. Because it basically allows the GM to just throw in these pilgrimages as the part of the campaign that they're doing right now. Many GMs that I know about have like these game sessions where they haven't had the time to prepare and haven't had the time to do the thing. So what you can do is just you look at the pilgrimage list and someone is need to go on a pilgrimage. And you talk to them and said, you should go on a pilgrimage today. And then him and the rest of the party sets out to do a pilgrimage. And the idea is basically that the pilgrimages are small mini adventures as well. The bigger ones that I just explained with the cannibalism and all that, that is going to be one of the really heavy ones. But the first ones are going to be more something that you would do anyway. So it's more like, go out of your way to find a religious enemy, kill them in one-on-one combat, or go out of your way and help someone bury a friend. And then you need to find someone that you help bury their friend, and then you do that. And that can basically put you on an entire campaign trail or an entire adventure. The GM can basically use that to build a story on the spot.
It's what, you die the hero or you live long enough to be the villain, right, Alex?
You die the hero, you live long enough to consume your friend's corpse,
Nathan. Which I think is pretty much the same thing, but you know, I don't. The thing that I find really interesting about that, though, is that so your characters are gaining power and they're getting more powerful, but in many ways they're losing a lot of stuff in the process. They have to be willing to commit to a lot of things that is going to tell you a lot of probably not great things about the character, depending on what they're willing to do.
What are you willing to do for more power? And also, yeah, one of the things I maybe didn't mention is that you don't lose any stats while you're at zero conviction. But things like how fast you regain the prayer and ritual power that you can use is actually lower than general. So you're actually, while you're at zero conviction, your character is punished for being at zero conviction because gods resent you right now. So why would they help you? It's a very punishing system. I actually talked with a professor who's a really great designer. I basically go to him whenever I have weird ideas about game design, and he tells me that they're really cool and I should do them. We talked about this, and he was, "This systems will put players in an infinite negative feedback loop. Either the negative feedback loop is I will be weaker until I do something horrible, and then it just keeps going forever, because you will have to use conviction to win some battles, or you will have to use conviction to unlock your character's powers for this while, because you need it right now, because you're fighting a very heavy battle, or you're doing something where you might need more power for the day, or whatever you need it for." So it's kind of the resource you never want to spend, but you always want to spend it because it gives you experience when you do it. How far do you want to go with your devotion compared to your character's strength?
What do you also potentially lose if you're not willing to do that? If you're not willing to go the whole route, you can be weakened because of it.
Like, if you decided, okay, I have done all the pilgrimages that I think my character would do. Do I keep playing this character, or do I retire him because he doesn't have more things to do? Do I retire her because there's a lot of things I want to see with another character from another character's perspective? Or do I keep playing them until the point where they have to spend their last conviction and actually take the decision of, do I want to stay weakened, or will I grasp for more power now? All of those are interesting character turns.
I think what you're going to find with that system, too, is that you've almost created like a sanity system, but for the players instead of the NPCs, because now they're going to have to like go through this psychological thing where they're like, oh, God, what am I doing? Am I willing to take my characters to places? Call of Cthulhu, but in a meta sense, you're asking the players to question their sanity about what they're willing to do with their characters. I think that's going to be interesting to see. When do you think people will be able to start playtesting that?
I am hoping that I will have a PDF or something like that available in maybe July or August. I'm hoping to be giving out like test rulebooks at events in Sweden in early 2020, late 2019, maybe at something like VisCon on Gotland, if anyone knows where that is. But like to get it into the hand of not people that I know or that have specifically contacted me about it. Or if you just want to contact me and like, I know I want to try this, then that's fine. Like, get in contact, send me a message on Twitter or Facebook, and I will tell you it's not done yet, but when it's done, I will try to remember to send you one. Send me a reminder in 1 month.
And we'll make sure to list everything for your contact info so that people can. If you would like to go on a pilgrimage that may result in you becoming a cannibal.
Or being cannibalized, perhaps.
Cannibalized. Hey, it's an eat-or-be-eaten world, right? Literally.
Yeah.
You know, like what they do in 5e is great for making it easy and accessible, but there are a lot of systems that can handle that in other ways that I think a lot of people would prefer.
Yeah, I think that progression has, over the years, went from being something that I make my character better, has becoming more and more, I want my character to become deeper not necessarily better, but it like I want more to play against. I want more flaws. I want more more strengths. I want more to bounce this character from, because it helps me play it well, but it also allows me to do important things while I'm playing. A lot of people, especially in Sweden, is playing so many different role-playing games. There's a game called Cult, so the Swedish version of Cult, which is it's spelled differently. It's weird. I don't remember if you play cultists or if you're actually just playing investigators. It's basically psychological horror role-playing, and it's so weird and it's so good. And then there's like children role-playing games called like Aventyr and Hjältarnas Tid, which is basically adventure and the time of the hero, which are basically made for people between the age of 8 and 13. There's also a kid role-playing game for superheroes called A Handbook for Superheroes, which is awesome. Yeah. So there's just a lot of like variety of games. And I haven't even mentioned the biggest ones, which is weird, because yeah. I should have, but it's...
That's all right.
There's way too many role-playing games in Sweden, and there's so many great ones.
At some point, maybe we'll come back to it, and we'll talk about some of the heavy hitters in Europe in general, because I do know that like the Euro gaming community is very prolific and probably has a far larger variety of stuff than we might even have here in the U.S. Those are some of the most interesting and diverse sort of ideas when it comes to systems as well.
Yeah, I think like America has a lot of people playing games, but I think that a lot of people in America are playing, I don't want to say non-diverse games, but I think that like if you play tabletop role-playing games in America, playing yeah. games like Dungeons and Dragons and Pathfinder is kind of the standard. While,
yes.
especially in Sweden, that's not the standard anymore. If someone says, I'm playing TTRPGs in Sweden, you have no idea what they're playing until you ask them.
So I think they said something like 80% of the market is D&D, and yeah. there's probably only four or five that are the majority of the rest of that. 95% or so of the gaming community around here probably is like probably five or six big ones. You know, like Edge of Empire and World of Darkness and Pathfinder, you know, those. Like, we've talked to so many indie developers at this point that I feel like that's starting to diverge out. But yeah, it's hard to take down the behemoths of the industry.
yeah, it's really hard. Like, I can just be guessing at a stereotype that I know about in Europe that isn't actually accurate. I've been working at making this role-playing game, and it's something I do in my personal leisure time, so it's not right. something that I've been like, I'm gonna market this, I'm gonna bring it to market, I'm gonna kickstart it, I'm gonna do all these things. And I would love for people to contact me and say, hey, I want to try this out, can you send me a PDF? That would be awesome. But it's not something right. that I'm gonna sit down and be like, I'm gonna market this and I'm gonna sell this, because it's like, this has been my baby project. This is actually more my baby project than State of Wonder, because it's been in the making for 10 years. It's been my playground project, where I've been just like, ooh, this is a cool thing. Now I take it away. Now this is a cool design thing, and now I take it away. I'm saying Excellent. Again, but I hope to have something I'm really happy with or satisfied with in midsummer this year.
Yeah, so we will try to keep people apprised of that and make sure that they have all the contact info so that they're able to keep abreast of that. Emelie Van Rodin, thank you so much for being back on the show.
Yeah, thank you for having me again, and it's been a great time again.
If anyone wanted to find out more information about, you know, the system that you're building, State of Wonder, anything that you're doing, where could they find you on the internet?
The easiest way is on Twitter or through my website, stateofwonderccg.com. Mm-hmm. We're trying to get a company page up, but it's still the easiest way to find out about what I'm working on, stateofwonderccg.com or my Twitter. We do regular updates on Facebook and Instagram as well, but the Twitter is more like where I just talk about my work and where I talk about what I'm doing. At @SOWGameDev.
Oh, and by the way, Alex, if people wanted to find out more information about Delve, where could they go?
You can find more information about Delve over at DelveCast.com.
Yep, everything that we do is over there. And while you are there, why not check out our Patreon? We have like full uncut episodes for you over there. And also some other fun things you can enjoy with your ears and your eyes, because there's some video stuff too. And thank you to our Shining Level patrons, Bonnie Ainsworth and Dominic Perry. follow us wherever you get your podcasts. We're locally sourced, handcrafted podcasts are distributed. The iTunes and the Google Play and the Spotify. You can find us on all those. And you can find us on Twitter as well. I'm at Citanium.
I'm at EXP Limited, and the show is at Delve Podcast.
I think we can all say that we have made plenty of progress today.
We can say something like that, yeah.
I'm going to say it.
I think you just did.
We've all made progress today. And all of you out there, imagine I'm doing like a winky thing and little thumbs up. That's what I'm giving you right now.
That's what you're doing right now.
Thanks for joining us, everyone. And we'll see you on the next episode. Bye now.
Bye.
Bye.